chess fans. Welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I am George Merejanian, program director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday from 7 to 11 at the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Production Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted in the control room by fellow resident and two-time Wachusett Chess Club champion, Bruce Felton. And behind the camera, we have two of the most dedicated FATV interns. We got Randy Harris from Fitchburg State University and Ty Dorsey from Mount Wachusett Community College. And with me, I have the honor and privilege of having back once again my special co-host, Rick Evans of Fitchburg, one of the most avid chess players in North Central Massachusetts. Welcome back, Rick. Good to have you back.
It's a pleasure to be here, George, anytime.
Well, Rick, it's always a pleasure having you back as my special co-host, filling in for my regular co-host, Marty Lane. But Rick, today we're going to focus our attention on the decision of the New York Times to end the chess column that it ran for 52 years. It axed the column less than a month ago. It was October 12, 2014, that the paper decided they got to pull the plug on the chess column. Now, what is your reaction to this decision of the newspaper to end this famed chess column?
Well, you know, it's worrisome because that's not the only newspaper to do that recently. There have been other very prominent chess columns that have run for years that were excellent.
Yes.
That have ended up in that same situation. So it's really a sad day for chess when we see this happening.
That is very true, because this is a very popular chess column in the major newspaper of this country.
Absolutely.
And during that 52-year run, there were three chess columnists. We should identify who those columnists were. The first chess columnist was Al Horowitz, Israel Albert Horowitz, known as Al Horowitz.
Al, yeah.
And we have a photo, a file photo of Al Horowitz. He actually wrote the first column on April 16, 1962. Here is a photo of Al Horowitz, who was a very strong player. His peak years were the 1930s and 40s. He was an editor of Chess Review magazine.
Chess Review, yeah.
Again, he competed in U.S. championships. He won the U.S. Open several times. So he was the first columnist. He wrote the column from 1962 until 1972.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in 1972, which happened to be, by the way, the year that Bobby Fischer mm-hmm. became world champion by beating Boris Spassky of Russia, in 1972, Robert Byrne, Grandmaster Robert Byrne, took over as the columnist.
Yeah.
And we have a photo of Robert Byrne, who was a very active player, but he wrote the column for 34 years, from mm-hmm. 1972 mm-hmm. until 2006 mm-hmm. when he retired.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the year after Robert Byrne retired as the columnist, a non-title, well actually, this player is a master, mm-hmm. has a World Chess Federation title, he's a FIDE master, or World Chess Federation master, mm-hmm. and he is Dylan McLean. Now, we do have a photo of Dylan McLean, who took over writing the column in 2007, and he wrote the column until the newspaper pulled the plug on mm-hmm. the column mm-hmm. on October 12, mm-hmm. 2014. So we're going to pay a tribute to these three columnists, especially the first two,
yes.
who were well-known masters. One was an international master, Al Horowitz, the other one, a world-renowned grandmaster, Robert Byrne. And we're going to present to our viewers a game that Robert Byrne played against Al Horowitz from the 1968 U.S. Championship.
Championship.
Do you know where that was held?
New York.
That was held. Most of the U.S. championships back in the 60s were held in New York City. Again, mm-hmm. now who had white in this game that was played in 1968 in the championship?
Robert Byrne.
Okay. So what did he play as his first move in this game?
He played e4.
Okay, let's play it. Okay, Now, this is a very good move. In fact, this is a move that Bobby Fischer swore by. That was his favorite opening move. You would never see him play. Well, he did on occasion play C4, but he believed in E4.
Yes.
Now, what Al Horowitz did in response to E4, he played E5. Okay.
And you don't see that as often as you'd expect. There are so many other alternatives.
No, this is known as a double king pawn opening right now.
And, and it's great to see that response because they lead to very exciting games.
Yes. But you're right.
Typically,
you don't see, this is not as commonly played now because...
As it used to be, say, at the turn of the century.
Absolutely. Or back. All right, so what did Byrne play for his second move?
The classic second move, taking the knight out to F3.
Okay. Which attacks the pawn on E5.
Yes, sure.
So that pawn under attack needs to be defended. Although there is a possibility of counterattacking, we could have actually played the knight to F6, which is a counterattack, which is known as the Petrov's defense, or possibly Russian defense. Some people call it Russian defense.
Yeah.
But the most logical reply would be developing a piece and defending the pawn on E5. Mm-hmm. At the same time, knight C6 was Horowitz's second move.
Yes.
All right, now White has to make a decision on the third move. What is possible here for White for move three?
There are a number of choices. There's the Italian game, bringing the light squared bishop out to C4.
Okay.
The queen's knight could be taken out to
developing
C3.
That piece, the knight to C3. Anything else?
A little bit slower game maybe might be to just advance the queen's pawn one square.
But that would shut in that bishop.
That would, yes.
But actually, even better, would bring it all the way
out. Or all the way out, which would be, I guess, the Scotch.
This is known as the Scotch Open, right? Exactly,
game.
Scotch
sure.
Open. All right, but what did the Byrne play, though?
Well, we have a Spanish game with a Roy Lopez, I guess another name.
And this is the characteristic move of the Roy Lopez?
Of the Roy Lopez.
Now, you know why it's called the Roy Lopez?
There was a Spanish priest it was at the 1500s or at some
in the 1500s.
It was quite a long time ago.
He was in the late
1500s. Who advocated this move?
Yes. He was Roy Lopez de Segura. He was born in Zafra in Extremadura, Spain. And he wrote a book in 1561, El Libro del Ajedrez, and he analyzed this move, Bishop E5. Now, most of the world refers to this opening as the Spanish opening. We in the English-speaking countries, England and the United States, of course, commonly refer to this as the Roy Lopez opening. Yeah, but this is a very solid, it's one of the oldest openings and a very solid, very good opening for White. Now, what Black did, what Black could have done, he could have actually developed this knight on G8 to F6, attacked the pawn.
The Berlin.
It's known as the Berlin,
Defense.
It's rather ironic. Isn't it? We have the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the Berlin Defense is now more commonly played now, but a move that was proved to be very effective is playing A6. The pawn on A6 attacks the bishop. It puts the question to the bishop, and it's asking White, what are your intentions? Why did you bring that bishop to B5? Is it to come here to attack the knight, which is defending the pawn, which is attacked by your knight? Or do you have other intentions? So A6 is what Horowitz played on his third move. Now, what did Byrne play?
Well, there are choices. He could have taken the knight, but chose not to.
That's true.
I suppose it's possible to retreat the bishop, but that didn't happen here.
And he's
not going to bring it back. That would be a waste of a tempo. So he retreats it back to A4.
Bishop A4. Okay. So he's still maintaining the pressure on that knight. Okay. By the way, you mentioned that the bishop could have taken that knight and exchanged bishop for knight. You know, Bobby Fischer, in his later years, actually advocated playing the exchange variation, but most players who play the Roy Lopez actually would retreat the bishop to A4. Okay, so now it's Black's turn. Horowitz now played on his fourth move, knight F6, which attacks the pawn on E4.
Which attacks the pawn.
Okay.
But so, it's nothing to worry about.
Do we have to protect that bond?
It's not necessary to protect it. Instead, the common move is to simply castle, which was played in this game.
Right. Okay. And that is the common move, right? Okay.
I think it's the most common response.
Now, Black has a choice here. Black actually could capture this pawn on e4, but if Black did that, he could come under attack with either the rook over to e1 or first
or advancing,
d4.
Advancing, yes, d4. That would be the most common.
Could d4 is more commonly played rook e1. Both
but
have
it's still
played.
A fairly even game, even, yeah. even you know, if it follows that line.
So what Black wants to do is keep the position closed. This is known as the closed variation, and decides to play the bishop to e7. He brings it to e here, to e7, getting ready to castle. Okay.
A lot of people will say that's one of the best spots for a
yes.
black bishop in a lot of openings. But
right, because it allows the bishop to operate on both sides
right,
of the board here.
Right.
Okay, so what did Byrne do on his sixth move?
He brings the rook over to e1.
So now he is protecting the pawn on e4. So now Black in this position could castle, right? Or no. Instead, he chooses to attack the bishop on a4 with b5.
Yes.
So we attack, and we're forcing white.
We're forcing. It's a forced forcing move
right.
Back to b3.
Okay. Now, can we not, as Black in this position, castle at this point?
I think you could.
Right. But Horowitz did not do that. He first played d6, further defending that pawn at e5.
Yes.
So we have the knight and the pawn on d6 over protecting that pawn on e5. Okay, so now what did Byrne do on his eighth move coming
well,
up?
Well, I think he makes a move that does a lot of quiet things.
Okay.
First of all, I think he's worried that this knight could come over and threaten the bishop and double his pawns.
Isn't that the threat?
That's a threat,
to come here?
Yes. So he must see that. And also, he'd like to support the center and get ready to advance the d-pawn.
Okay.
So he makes a preparatory move, which gives this bishop an escape square should the knight come here.
All right.
And also supports a possible advance of the d-pawn in the future.
All right. So so this does support the advance of a pawn to d4. But, as you pointed out, that bishop does have an escape square. Even after Black, Horowitz in this position, did come knight a4 and attack the bishop.
Yes.
He would love to eliminate that light-squared bishop.
Yeah. I often wonder why this is played, because it puts the knight off, you know, to, grimly on the rim
of
the
board.
A knight on the rim is grim because, you know, a knight has a certain sphere of influence, and half of that sphere is cut off by lack of board over.
Normally, you would not advocate anyone putting knights on the side of the board. Mm. They have less effectiveness on the side. As you say, the knight on the rim is grim or dim. I mean, it's not a good place to have a knight. But again, he's forcing that bishop now.
He's forcing the bishop back off of a key diagonal that's bearing down on a sensitive point in the king position.
So Byrne now plays bishop c2.
Plays the bishop back.
All right, so in response to that, Horowitz, on his ninth move, played c5. He wants to challenge this attack of this preparation of d4 with c5.
And Black is gaining space here, and I think has a pretty good game. I wouldn't think that White is in any superior position. Black is fine here, with a nice even game, with this nice space advance and pawn advance on the queen side.
True.
So White does not want to cede the center here, so this preparatory move now helps with this advance of the pawn from d2 to d4.
Yeah, and by playing this pawn to d4, in effect, White now has a double attack on this pawn on e5, which is only protected by this pawn on d6.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a question of, does Black want to exchange pawns here, e takes d4, or does Black want to maintain what we call a strong point by maintaining a pawn on e5? And the way to do that is to play queen c7. Now the queen on c7 and the pawn on d6 adequately defend the pawn on e5. All right, so now what does Byrne do in response to this move?
Well, many things could be done, but I think White's a little bit concerned by this pawn onslaught coming on the queen side and wants to do something about that. And the move a2 to a4 challenges this pawn advance and attempts to break it up in some way.
Right, and the pawn on a4 is attacking the pawn on b5, which
yes.
is, however, defended by the pawn on a6.
Yes.
Now, black in this position could just continue with development, could play the bishop to b7, doesn't have to worry because the rook is protecting that knight. If this file is opened up, there's adequate defense here for black. But instead, after a4, black, Horowitz, chose to advance the pawn to b4.
Mm-hmm. All right,
so that's what he did, b4 on the 11th move.
And now white attempts to disrupt or break up this pawn formation.
Okay.
Usually it said, you know, it's best to try to break it up at the base, but that's not possible here.
Okay.
It's sort of interesting. I mean, I see that these pawns are all pointing queenside, so you would think that black is looking for some queenside activity here.
Right.
Whereas you see white's pawns are aiming at the king's side, so you would think that white ultimately would like to do something on the king's side
yes.
of the board. I mean, my primitive reading of the position.
It's a good reading.
But here there's a...
Okay, so white plays C takes B4.
Yes, C takes B4.
And black responds with C takes B4.
Yes.
All right, so we have pawn exchange. All right, so now it's white's move here. A move 13 coming up.
A simple developing move. This knight comes out to d2.
Yeah, in fact, that's the only square the knight can go to. Can't go to a3 or c3 because the pawn controls those squares. So knight bd2 is white's move, and again, black still could castle in this position, but chooses to develop another piece, bishop to b7. We now have a double attack on
which is,
the pawn.
I think, a great move.
It's a good move.
And I would, wouldn't you rate this position as pretty equal right now?
Yes, I would say.
Would you give an edge to either side?
Well, I would give a slight advantage spatially to white.
Because of the two pawns
yes,
in the
yes,
center?
Exactly. I think I would still give it, but it's very so slight, it's very minute. Now, after bishop b7, what did Byrne do on his 14th move?
Well, ultimately, he wants to develop this dark squared bishop, and it's sort of shut in by the knight and by this pawn at the moment.
Okay.
And I think he doesn't want to be embarrassed by this pawn advancing further, so he cuts off that possibility and makes a square for the bishop to
Develop to b2.
To develop to b2.
Okay. Now, at this point, black finally castles. And it took him, 14 moves to do it?
Mm.
So black castles here.
But you know, I think that running this game as I did through computer analysis,
yes.
this turns out to be not one of the top five moves given by the computer.
So you're saying this has been played?
And I'll tell you why.
Okay.
The computer, I believe, is looking at dominance of this file by black, and the computer thought that bringing this rook
over
and dominating this file would provide better
actually
play.
Forcing that bishop to move.
Yes.
The bishop actually would have
yes.
to make another...
But that wasn't chosen in the game, but I wonder what would have happened had it been chosen.
Yes, play rooks. Yeah, I can see the advantage of putting a rook on the file immediately and forcing that bishop now to make a decision as whether going back to b1 or going up to d3. But Horowitz is a man. This was played back, 46 years ago.
No computers.
Played what was commonly played back then, castle. So he castled on the 14th move. Now it's Byrne's move.
And so we've wanted to develop this bishop.
Right.
And so it's developed.
Now what is the threat? By putting the bishop on b2, doesn't white have a threat?
Well, one of the key points in this game, as I mentioned before, I think white would like to play for some kingside activity.
Yes.
And this is a very important point.
This pawn here.
This pawn is an important strong point. I believe you called it a strong
yes.
point at the beginning of the game.
Chess players, I know, refer to that. This as a strong point. If you could maintain this strong point, you've actually held off any aggression by white. But this pawn is now being attacked how many times now? With this bishop on b2.
Well, it's attacked by the knight, the pawn, and the bishop.
So three times.
We have three times.
And I only see it being defended twice. So it's in danger of falling. We have black is, it could actually lose that pawn if that pawn is not defended again. And the only way to defend that pawn again is to play the knight on f6 and play it back to d7.
But to my mind, black is being pushed into more and more of a defensive posture over the course of the next few moves. I think this is the beginning of a defensive rather than an offensive posturing.
Right. Okay. Well,
again, necessary, but... But you get that feeling.
He has no choice here. I mean, he has to defend that pawn. But if he can maintain this strong point, let's see how long he can maintain this strong point on e5. Now, the move that's going to come up now is move 16 for white. And what did white play now on move 16?
A reorganization of the pieces for greater activity in the center and toward the king side. So there's a shuffling of some of the pieces that are already developed. I believe the knight comes over to...
Yeah. So you mentioned the word restructured. When you said that, I was
thinking... Reshuffle or...
Reorganization or restructuring. What came to me in mind when you said that? Perestroika. Gorbachev used the word perestroika, which actually in Russian means restructuring. We're going to redeploy that knight on F1. It's not going to stay there. But it's going to come back into action in a different structure. All right, so after knight f1, what Horowitz did on his 16th move was play rook on f8 to e8. So he brings the rook over to this file, which once this bishop is moved out of the way, will add further defense on the pawn on e5.
Yes.
Okay.
And so white also would like to activate a rook. Now, looking at this, the queen, now had the rook been brought over earlier instead of the castling, black would be stronger here.
That's true.
But by bringing this rook over to c1, the rook is lined up in a threatening way with the queen. Of course, the bishop is interposed for the time being, that must be uncomfortable for black.
Horowitz now played bishop f8. That was his 17th move. What did Byrne play?
Well, don't you think that's a very defensive sort of a move?
It's clear that white is pushing
black around
black
here
a little
bit.
Black is definitely in a defensive mode
here. That
of course, this knight on a5 is doing nothing here. So what did Byrne do here in response to bishop f8 on the 18th move?
As I recall, I think the knight is redeployed to e3.
Right. It did go to the e3. Okay. So at this point, Horowitz now plays. This rook is very nicely placed on this open file. The queen now gets off this file.
Good idea.
Queen d8. Yes.
You don't want to be. And plus, maybe seeing this buildup of pieces on the king side.
Yes.
It's not a bad idea to be able to shift your queen over.
Yes. Okay. So what did Byrne do after queen d8?
Okay.
There's a move 19 coming up.
Yes. This is the point in the game where...
This knight is going to actually
So the queen being pushed back, if the knight advances more, now we're having an incursion into the black camp here.
All right.
So this knight is very well placed. I don't think the bishop is going to want to take it.
No, because semi-opened this file here. No, what black does here, Horowitz realizes this knight is doing nothing on a5. He wants to come back into action, and he plays knight c6. All right, so knight c6. Now what does Byrne do after knight c6? It's his 20th move coming up.
The 20th move, I think he puts the queen in a little bit more active square and links the rooks on the back rank.
Oh, but I also see that the knight and the queen are threatening.
Also a double attack on this.
And he's threatening to win that pawn.
Right.
Okay. So what black could have actually just played the pawn to a5 and just defended.
But he has an unprotected bishop there as well, this black bishop. It's not good, to as you go through the game, to have unprotected pieces because they lead to tactics being played against you.
Okay. What Horowitz played was rook b8.
And I suppose the reason for that is to not have some tactic based upon this bishop at some point.
No, but there is a tactic. There's a trap. He's setting a trap. You know what the trap is? Let's show our viewers that we can actually have the cameras look at this position. By playing the rook to b8,
Can white now take and win this pawn, like doing this? Follow this very carefully. Knight takes b4.
Uh-huh.
Then knight takes b4. And queen takes b4. And white is won a pawn, right?
Yes, because this bishop can take
but
this.
But the problem with that is, yes, the bishop can take the pawn on e4. The rook attacks the queen.
Attacks the queen, which has to move.
And the bishop now, on the next move, is going to eliminate this light squared bishop. Mm-hmm. So that is the tactic that white has if white were to fall for taking that pawn on b4.
Not likely that Byrne would fall for that, though.
Right, exactly.
When you get to lofty...
But again,
a beginner. Oh, I would fall for that.
Yes, by playing the rook here. Yeah. Well, a beginner said, wait a minute, this doesn't protect the pawn on b4. I can take the pawn, but that would be a mistake. Now, what did Byrne do now after rook b8? 21st move coming up for white.
I have to remember now. I think the bishop is coming in front of the queen here.
Right.
To lend a little bit more support to the center, but also to have the rook opened up on the c-file.
That's a good move. Okay, so now what? Now here is where Black Horwitz relinquishes his strong point and plays e takes d4.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think we were going to see this, but he did it. I wouldn't have done this if I were playing this position. I would have tried to still maintain this strong point. So what did Byrne do here?
He takes back with a knight.
Yep. And again, we have to move this game on a little further because our time is running out.
So
in response to this, Black plays knight takes, knight to c5, attacking
the bishop, which has to come back because it's not a piece you want to give up.
Yeah, but the bishop goes back to the c2. And now we're going to defend that pawn by playing a5.
Yes, sure.
Okay.
To shore that up, but now we can take advantage of these aggressive knights.
Okay, so knight f5 is played by Byrne, and on the 24th move, Horwitz plays the knight to e5.
But unfortunately, it can be chased away by the f-pawn advance to f4.
So the knight has to retreat, can't stay there.
A key move, probably the key move of the game.
So we're talking about this is the turning point in the game
I think so, at least computer analysis would say that this is the turning point.
Here is where Black makes the big mistake. Plays knight g6.
Yes.
Okay.
Which falls to a tactic.
Okay, and how does Byrne to take advantage of that mistake?
He makes this very interesting knight check to h6.
And the king cannot move out of check because the knight would be able to take the pawn on f7 and fork the king and queen and win the queen.
Mm-hmm.
So this sacrifice must be taken, g takes h6, okay? And now
another brilliant knight attacking move, calling check again.
Okay. And what's surprising is that Horwitz took the knight with the queen because he realizes if he moves the king, the knight's going to take the rook with check.
Yes.
And then it's going to go back with check and come back here with check and win this rook. So he decided,
which the computer gives is Black's best option, believe it or not.
Right,
so the queen is lost.
So bishop takes f6.
Yeah.
Okay. And now what happens here? What does he do here?
He takes the pawn.
The queen.
The bishop takes the
bishop
knight.
Bishop takes e4.
The bishop takes the bishop.
Bishop takes e4.
The bishop retreats to b2.
All right. Well, how about if we just play the bishop back here to f5, which he did.
Which he did. The queen advances to d4.
And now the queen, the bishop, and the knight are paralyzed. They can't move.
Right.
And what he did here was play the bishop back to e6.
And then the last move in the game, Byrne moves the queen to f6.
And resigned because the threat is
there. And then there's a resignation because this pawn is coming down. And
Well, that was the game. Sports chess fans, we hope you enjoyed what Rick and I presented. We'll see you next time on the next edition of Chess Chat. Hope you enjoyed the game.
And we got it in just barely in time.
Yeah, it was a longer game.